Hello, Internet. This is Ask Melissa again, this time showing you how to solve systems of equations using fixed point iteration. We'll go over some examples, talk about the Banach fixed point theorem, and discuss order. This video does require some background knowledge of fixed point iteration for finding roots of one equation. I recommend watching my earlier videos on these topics if you haven't already. For solving systems of equations, you should have at least as many equations as you do unknowns, and fixed point iteration will actually work for both linear and nonlinear systems of equations. When it comes to solving a system, there could be no solution, an infinite number of solutions, or a finite number. And for nonlinear systems, you can't use things like Gaussian elimination to solve them. You could try to solve them algebraic way or an iterative numeric way, like this video will show you how to do with fixed point iteration. As the basis for this video, we'll use the nonlinear system of x squared minus y equal to 1 and x minus y squared equal to negative 1, which has these four solutions. So how does fixed point iteration work? First, rewrite your equation so that you can isolate your variables. For example, x is equal to something and y is equal to something. You can also represent it using a vector. For example, capital X is xy. Then we label the left-hand side with n plus 1 and the right-hand side with n. Then pick a starting value for x and iterate until you find a solution. So let's rewrite these expressions. First, the green one. We can simply take y to the other side and then divide everything by x, giving us x sub n plus 1 is equal to y of x sub n plus 1 over x sub n. For our other equation, we can move x over, then divide everything by minus 1 and take the square root. Of course, this gives us two answers for our new y. Therefore, we can break this up into two separate solutions. As you might imagine, there are many different ways that we can rearrange these functions. Regardless, you'll still need to have one that you created from the first function and one that you created from the second, in this case, one green and one blue. Let's keep things simple and just use the square root of y plus 1 and the square root of x plus 1 as our system of equations. If we start at 1, 2, we plug them into our new systems of equations, and this gives us square root of 3, square root of 2. We plug that in to get a new value for x, and then plug that in to get our next x. If we graph this on the xy plane with our original system of equations, starting from 1, 2, performing one iteration of fixed point iteration, computing the next value, and the next value, eventually we're actually reaching a solution. Let's ignore the numbers and just look at our steps. This is our first step, followed by our second step, our third, and our fourth, and you can kind of tell that our steps are getting smaller each iteration. Let's put the numbers back in and figure out what is the length of this step. If we use that step as the hypotenuse of a right triangle labeled as A, B, and C, then C is equal to the square root of A squared plus B squared. And to figure out A and B, we just need to do subtraction. This gives us our length of C. Given our sequence of iterations, if we compute the distance between each iteration, you'll notice that the distance approaches zero. The trouble is that these are actually not Cartesian points. They're Banach spaces, named after Stefan Banach. We can think of them more like vectors. And to compute the norm of a vector, in this case the L2 norm, we'll simply take the square root of the sum of squares. For example, the norm of x1 is equal to the square root of 5. And the norm of x2 minus x1 is our distance function. We know that we can stop iterating with fixed point iteration when the norm of our steps becomes less than some epsilon. Or if we take our original function and rewrite it in terms of zero, we can stop it when the norm of the function at our x is less than some epsilon, or whenever we reach some maximum number of iterations. So far, we've been able to find this solution using fixed point iteration, but what if we wanted to find this one? With our set of equations starting at 1, 2, we found our first solution at 1.618 for x and 1.618 for y. If we instead start at negative 0.6 and negative 0.7, this should give us a better chance at finding our second solution. And indeed, this one ends up at our first one again. Let's instead use a different set of equations. And if we start from negative 0.6 and negative 0.7, this ends up diverging. If we use another set of equations starting from that point, after 55 iterations, we're able to find our second solution. So when does it converge? Recall how we rewrote our equations to be x is equal to something and y is equal to something. We call that something g of x, such that x sub n plus 1 is equal to g of x sub n. When our norms are getting smaller, this means the distance between our steps is shrinking. And when we have a sequence of shrinking steps, we call this Cauchy. We can also rewrite it to look like this. Things are going to get a little technical now, but bear with me. First, we say that there exists a solution x star, such that f of x star is 0. And a Cauchy sequence 2x star is generated by g of x, given this sequence, and that's Cauchy. We can say that a contraction mapping creates a Cauchy sequence. A contraction mapping basically says that for any two points, the norms between them are greater than the norm of the functions subtracted from those points. More formally, we'll write it like this with an L variable in front. Then, g of x is guaranteed to converge if it is a contraction mapping. Let's go back a bit and look at our x's, but more specifically, our change in x's. If we take a matrix, which we'll just call J, and multiply it by our change in x's, there's something peculiar that happens. Each new change in x is approximately this special sequence J times our old change in x. Maybe this will help. Using that expression, we can say that J, our Jacobian, is G prime at x star. To find G prime, using our example g, we take the partial derivative of every equation in g against every variable in g. Using x star, which is the solution to our first system of equations, plug that into g prime to get our Jacobian. So how does this help us? Using our contraction mapping condition, which looks like this, and our Jacobian multiplication expression that looks like this, if you replace two of those x's with g of x, then take the norm of everything, we can say that the norm of j is an upper bound on L. In this case, the norm is still the square root of the sum of squares of all terms in j. When our norm is less than 1, then g is going to be guaranteed to be a contraction mapping. Using our first set of equations, we can compute g prime using partial derivatives. Then, if we plug in x star, in this case values of phi, we can compute j. Then, by taking the norm of j, we get about 0.44, which is less than 1, and therefore it passes the convergence test. Using our second set of equations, we can also find g prime. Then, plugging in x star, we can compute j. Taking the norm of j, we get about 1.66, which fails the test. What if we instead use our second solution and plug this into j? Taking the norm of j in this case also fails the test. What about our last set of equations? We know that this one found our second solution. If we compute g prime and plug in our second solution, we can compute j. Then all we do is take the norm of j, and wait a second, this also failed the test? Earlier I referred to it as the convergence test, but really it is the contraption mapping test. Passing it guarantees it to be a contraption map. Failing it only means that there is no guarantee. Also, if you needed to x star to find j, then what was the point of trying to guarantee its convergence, because you already know the solution? Think of it as, is g a mapping to x star? Also, having j is a good indicator of the change in step size. You can avoid a lot of this by using generalized Aiken-Stephenson's method, which is the subject of another video. Now, what about the all-important order? Let me refer to Peter Henrici's book, Elements of Numerical Analysis. Here is my library's copy. Henrici writes, if j is not equal to 0, that is, if the elements of the matrix j are not all 0, it shows that the area vector is approximately multiplied by the Jacobian. In this sense, we again may speak of linear convergence. If j is equal to 0, that is, if all four elements of j are 0, then we see that this expression. This is similar to what earlier has been quadratic convergence. To find the exact order will depend on your sequence. You can use three consecutive errors like we have with our order formula from earlier. If you've seen my other videos, here the error is either the norm of f of x of n or the norm of x of n minus x star. Using our example from earlier, plugging in three errors, we get about a linear order. Going back to the slide from earlier, we've been able to find two solutions, but what about these other two? I'll leave those for you to find. Some parting notes. Fixed point iteration can converge even if it's not guaranteed to be a contraction map, and it also works with complex numbers. Usually the L2 norm is good enough, but you might need to use a different norm if things aren't working out well. And I oversimplified the Banach fixed point theorem. This is probably the discussion of another video all on its own. You can also use the generalized form of Aitken's method to accelerate convergence, induce convergence, and avoid the convergence mapping test altogether. The code that I used will be hosted on GitHub. Thank you very much for watching. This video took a lot of iterations to get right, and I hope things made sense. Please comment with your thoughts, questions, and suggestions for future videos. I will highly recommend that following this video, you watch my other video on generalized Aitken-Stephenson's method, which follows up on key topics from this video.